All right, I'm excited for this one because these are my favorite videos to share. And the reason why I love sharing them is because it lets me showcase the constant innovations and improvements that we're adding to Lightroom. To that end, yesterday Adobe released Lightroom Desktop 8.2 for Mac and Windows. And as is the case with these updates, we've added support for a bunch of new cameras and lenses, and we've also squashed a healthy amount of bugs. Here's the thing though, we also introduced several new features, one of which made its way from Adobe Camera Raw, and two new ones that I've been waiting years for. But instead of me teasing you about it, how about I show you what you can expect in Lightroom Desktop 8.2? Let's dive in. All right, so there are three key features that I want to show you available now in Lightroom Desktop 8.2. But before I do, I have to remind you the first thing you'll want to do is update to 8.2. And to do that, you'll load the Creative Cloud Desktop app on Mac or Windows. And on the left here, you'll click on Apps, and then you can click on View Updates and make sure that you see Lightroom Desktop 8.2 there. If you don't, sometimes I found rebooting your computer will help, and then go into the Creative Cloud Desktop app and you'll be good to go. Once you have 8.2 installed, you'll be able to follow along with these new features. So the first feature I mentioned actually is now in Lightroom Desktop, as well as Lightroom Classic, Lightroom Mobile, and Lightroom Web, and that is the Adaptive Profiles. These were first available in Adobe Camera Raw, which you can access through Photoshop or Bridge, but now they're accessible in all surfaces of Lightroom, which is awesome. And I'm going to show you what adaptive profiles are, but I'm not going to spend a lot of time on it because I'm going to create a whole separate video focused specifically on these profiles. It's worth it. They're pretty deep. They're super powerful, but here's the gist of it. So for the most part, when I start editing a photo, if I want to see what, you know, what I can do with the photo, I click on auto. And auto, it does a decent job of showing me, you know, it wrangles in tones and it boosts color, but it pretty much just kind of treats the image globally. Like, it makes global edits. As you can see here, we actually manipulated the sliders when we clicked on auto. Adaptive profiles, which you'll find over here, either by clicking on the dropdown, you'll see there is adaptive color, and then further down is adaptive black and white, takes a much more intelligent approach. So these adaptive color and black and white profiles were trained using AI, and I absolutely love them because they are applied on an image by image basis. So the profile will look at your image and make adjustments based on the characteristics of the image, based on the subject, based on the sky, and it just feels a lot more natural and a lot more tailored. And the best part is because we're using a profile, so in this case here, if I apply adaptive color, you'll see how none of the sliders are affected. Now, let me undo that really quickly because I want to show you the differences between the auto button and adaptive color in this case. So I'm going to go to versions here, and I already created two versions and you can see them here. This is just the auto button, and then this is adaptive color, and then this is the original. So I want to focus on original and adaptive color. Notice how, hopefully you can notice, I definitely can notice, but there is a specific kind of edit made to the sky and then a different edit to the foreground and to the subject. Whereas with auto, it's just kind of this global adjustment that's made. And again, it's using the sliders. It's actually editing the sliders, whereas the adaptive color profile doesn't. And so for me, I've been testing the adaptive color profile in Lightroom for a little while now, and I have fallen in love with it. It's pretty much the first thing that I do now. I don't even use auto anymore. And this is an important point. So let's go ahead here. I'm going to click on this version to apply the adaptive color profile. And you'll see when we go back to edit over here, that profile is applied here. Now, we don't recommend using the adaptive color profile in conjunction with auto. I would say use one or the other. And we go so far as to give you a warning. So watch, with adaptive color applied, if I click on auto, you will see this warning dialogue that says, for best results, avoid using them both. Now, of course, you can bypass and click apply, or you can click don't apply. And then of course you can click on don't show me again. I'm gonna go ahead and click on don't apply. Now, if I reset things here and I click on auto, and then I go ahead and I apply the adaptive color, you will see the same dialogue, just to show you that it goes both ways. So I'm going to click on don't apply, undo, and then let's just apply the adaptive color profile. Now, of course, as with any other profile, you do have this amount slider, so you can dial in or out the strength, and you can just see how the sky gets just a little bit more pronounced as I go from off to on. And I love that. I think it's awesome. And of course, don't forget, there is also adaptive black and white, which operates similarly to the adaptive color profile, except it will work into converting your image to black and white. Another really, really awesome highlight, pun partially intended, of adaptive color and adaptive black and white is that it works especially well if you're editing your image in HDR. Now, unfortunately, this probably doesn't look very good anymore because I cannot capture HDR with this screen recording software. So the point I want to make, though, is if you are editing in HDR, and actually this is something I have absolutely fallen in love with, like I edit all of my photos now in HDR, and I go through the process of sharing them on Instagram and on Threads in HDR because it just looks so much better. But my point is that if you are editing in HDR, adaptive color and adaptive black and white work especially well here. Like that is kind of like its jam. So I highly recommend checking out the adaptive color and adaptive black and white profiles if you're using HDR. But again, I'm going to go ahead and turn this off so we can have this back in an SDR range. Now, I did mention that the adaptive color and black and white profiles use AI. And so there is a consideration to make with kind of the order of operations. What I mean by that is you can see that I have adaptive color applied. And let's say I go ahead and I go to the remove tool here and I have this little dust spot right there. So I'm going to go ahead and click on it to get rid of it. Now watch when I go back to edit, you'll see that some AI settings need to be recomputed. That's because there are edits being made with the profile to the sky and foreground. And so I'm going to go ahead and click on update. And there we go. We're off to the races. Now, when the adaptive profiles were first announced, there was a fantastic blog post that was also published that explains exactly what this is. And it goes into really deep detail. So I'm going to leave a link to that below. I highly recommend you check it out. And again, I kind of glossed over this. Look for a video not too far from now where I'm going to go into much greater detail on how you can use the adaptive profiles. It's a perfect opportunity for you to click on the subscribe button and the bell icon so you don't miss out on that. Now, one last thing that I need to bring up about using the adaptive color and black and white profiles is that they currently work with RAW and DNG files. So if you were to try to open up a JPEG or a TIFF or a PNG file, you wouldn't have the adaptive color profile or the adaptive black and white profile listed in this dropdown or in the profile browser. All right, now let me show you the first new feature to Lightroom Desktop in this update. And that has to do with dual monitor support. So dual monitor is just one of those things that I really miss from my Lightroom Classic days. I love the idea of having my grid on one display and my detail view on the other display. To me, it's just a more engaging way to interact with my photo library. Well, we can do that now. And so you can see I have my two displays here. Normally I just show this one, but I wanna show you how dual monitor works. And so it's gonna look a little tiny, but it'll make sense. When we detect two displays connected to your computer, you'll see this icon down here appear, and it's a dual monitor display. When you click on the down arrow, you'll have these options here for a photo grid, a square grid, and detail view. I'm gonna go ahead and click on photo grid, and you'll see that we now have a grid in the secondary display. You'll also notice that you can only have the grid view on one display at a time. So watch, if I go to the primary display here and I press G, it assumes the grid view and the secondary display will get a detail view. All right, let's take a closer look now at the secondary display and what options you have. So you'll see this toolbar on the bottom here. And the first thing that I just want to show you is how you can interact with it. If you click on the ellipsis over here, you'll see you have the option to hide it altogether. So let's go ahead and just hide it. And if you want to get back to it, you'll go to the view menu, then you'll go to secondary window and you'll click on show contextual taskbar. And there you go. You also have the ability to move it from the bottom to the top, or you can go ahead and select undock, which will allow you to position it wherever you want. Now, personally, I am partial to the bottom, so that's what I keep it at. Now let's move along from the left. So I mentioned how you can only have the grid view on one display. So if you want it on this display on your secondary, you have two options. You can either select the photo grid. You can also have the square grid, which is what I use. I like having more info density. Now, just going over here, you can see that you can control the thumbnail size. So if you want, again, larger thumbnails, which I prefer, you can adjust that with that slider. And of course, you can also apply a star rating and a flag, whether the pick or the reject flag is applied to your photo. I also want to show you another fun way to use dual monitor. So let's say I want to have a gigantic before and after. Well, I can do that. Watch. So I've got this image here. I'm going to go ahead and I'm going to change this to detail view. Remember, you can have detail view on both displays. You just can't have a grid view on both displays. When I go into detail view, you'll see this lock icon appear over here. And what that does is it will essentially lock the image at whatever state it's in at the time when you click it. So here, because this image is in the original unedited state, I can now go to the primary display here and I can do things like click auto, for example, and I can make adjustments really quickly. And you'll see how this image will never update on the secondary display until I unlock. So I'm going to click the lock here and you'll see how the image updates. Now, if I click on the lock again over here, I can go ahead and make edits and only the primary display will update. The secondary display will stay locked. Also worth noting in detail view is you do have zoom controls. So here, if I want, I can, you know, zoom in tight and then zoom to fit. So I think this is a fun way to use the dual monitor support that is now available in Lightroom Desktop 8.2. I'll go ahead and reset the image here. And now we're back to the original state. But again, for me personally, I'm pretty much always going to be in the square grid on my secondary display and then using my primary display to edit my photo. All right, so you know how I just showed you how you can use the two displays for that kind of giant before and after? That actually allows me to segue into the third new feature. This is also brand new to Lightroom Desktop. And again, it's one of those things that I really miss from Lightroom Classic. And I absolutely love that we are doing this. We are taking the most important features from Lightroom Classic and we're bringing them over to Lightroom Desktop. And it just shows our commitment to building out this platform. So what am I talking about? Well, it is the ability to have a before and after view in the compare mode. It's one of those little things that if you never had it, you don't realize how important it is and how useful it is. But again, coming from Classic, it's one of those things that I really did miss. So let me show you how it works. Go ahead and I'll just open an image here. This is of this Osprey flying at me. And we've always had this compare view, or at least we've had it for a very long time. When I click on this, the default view, or really the only option that we had, was this multiple images view. And so what you can see here is that first, this film strip appears, and I have two different images shown side by side. And that's fine if, like, I was trying to compare two similar images together, but this doesn't really make sense here. What I really want is to see kind of the before and after. I want to see the original unedited photo, and then I want to see the current treatment next to it. So what I can do is I can click on this drop down here, and this is new. Now we have before and after. And you can see we now have, this is the edited image on the right, and we have the original unedited photo here. You can see how it has the original crop. Obviously, no edits were made to the sky or to the bird. So I love that we have this here. I can click on E to hide the edit drawer, and we now have even more screen real estate to look at the before and the after. We also have other options here, like I can change the orientation if I want the images on top of each other. That works as well. I prefer it side by side. And then if you want to have the after on the left, I can click on swap and swap those positions. And then I can also click on these other images. And as I do, you can see, like, this is very helpful to see the original photo and then the edit. And then same thing here. And again, it's just one of those little things that if it's something you never had, you don't know how important it is. But if you've had it and then you go without it, I mean, I am so happy that we have this here. I use this all the time. And I think it's something that now that you have it, you're going to use it all the time too. So with that, like I said, I'm just really, really excited about all the features that we're getting in Lightroom. Lightroom 8.2 brings some important things. Again, we've got adaptive profiles that are not just on Lightroom Desktop. They're in Classic, they're in mobile, they're in web. They're really powerful. And again, I'm going to share a video diving more deeply into that. So be sure to check that out when it drops. And if you want to learn everything there is to know about Lightroom, Lightroom Desktop, Lightroom Mobile, and Lightroom Web. I've shared this many times, but I have a course called Lightroom Everywhere. It's got over 11 hours of lessons that'll teach you everything you need to know. I am updating the course with these new features, so you'll have that there as well. I'll leave a link to that in the description below. And I've got this playlist here. I mean, it has all of my Lightroom editing tutorials. So if you want to just learn more on YouTube, check out this playlist here. Of course, if you found this video helpful, a thumbs up is always appreciated. And please be sure to click on the subscribe button and the bell icon to get notified of all future videos. Thanks a lot, everyone.